apostles, the apostles didn't, were not expecting him. He said this for the first time, and they had not heard him say this before. So this was Jesus stepping outside of his normal routine, and stepping outside his comfort zone or outside his box, and saying something totally different, and Peter got really mad. And then Jesus said, "Get behind me." He said, "Get behind me, Satan. I have to say this. This is part of the plan. You have to follow it. If you want to follow me, follow God's plan." Okay? So this is what we're going to do. We're going to play a game. Okay? So everybody stand up. Okay. Here's the box. All right? And I'm going to show you how this works. So I'm going to step in the box. All right? This is my box. This is what I'm used to doing all the time. Okay? So I make dinner for the kids, and I go to work, and I do laundry. All right, those are all things that I do in my box. All right? If I step outside my box, I'm going to do something totally different. Like go on a hike in the Himalayas. Okay? Or eat worms. That's outside my box, right? Okay, so come down here, and I'm going to give people some cards. All right? All right, there you go. And if I want you to read this, all right? And you're going to tell me there's no wrong answer. That's okay, we'll help you. You tell me, all right? And you read it off, and we're going to decide if that's going to be in the box or out of the box, okay? All right? And there's no wrong answer, all right? It's what you're comfortable with doing and what you've never done before, okay? What is it? What's it say? All right, are you used to doing that? You're in the box. Okay, so you're used to doing that. Okay, perfect. All right. That's exactly how we're going to do it. What about you? Okay, is that in the box thing for you or out of the box? Playing with friends at recess. In the box. Perfect. Okay. All right. Next. Inviting the new kid. Do you do that normally? No. Okay. Apologizing Isn't that cool? That's what Jesus did when he said those new things and he told people that sometimes we don't need to follow our plan, but we gotta follow God's plan. He's like, you guys gotta get outside the box. Alright? Jesus has a huge box. Okay, let's pray.
Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake, and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
And then, since we're doing inside and outside of the box, we're switching places today. Mark Bucci is going to do a sermon. Are you ready? No? All right. Was on the cross. This is probably the hardest and most important question that Christianity has asked itself throughout history. Who was that was on the cross? And, I mean, on one level, it's pretty straightforward. Jesus of Nazareth, right? So, a man that people knew with varying degrees of familiarity, and that the state suspected of treason, and the church at the time suspected of heresy, right? That's who was on the cross. But there's a whole bunch of issues that come up. The biggest one, historically, not the one that Peter is addressing, but the biggest issue that we have about who's on the cross is, if you make claims about this Jesus of Nazareth, that he was Then you're presented with this really massive problem, which is, it's not just some guy on the cross. It's anywhere from a holy and anointed one on the cross, a prophet, or, you know, some kind of, like, person that God has placed special blessing on, all the way up to, these are some of the claims that have been made over the course of Christianity, all the way up to, that is God on the cross in human form. And depending on how you answer this question, who was that on the cross, then what the cross means or signifies, what we believe about God, what we believe about humanity, all of that gets mixed up into this one kind of really significant moment. And so where the church landed on this is actually, on one level, it's very definable and straightforward and clear. Who's on the cross? Jesus Christ, Son of God, fully God, and Jesus Christ, born of Mary, fully human. What you have on the cross is this unique person . Then you gotta sort out a whole bunch of stuff. Because, okay, so for just to pick up a simple example, generally speaking, in not just in Christianity, but in most religions, especially the biggest ones, there are certain kinds of attributes of God, right? Like, we just kind of define God in certain ways. Some of those are like real like attributes of God. God is just, or God is merciful, or God is creator, or stuff like that. And then some of the definitions we have of God are more cataphatic, like we define God by what we're not. So we can suffer, so God can't suffer. We change, so God is immutable, doesn't change. So we define God by what human beings aren't. So then you have this problem. You've got this guy on the cross, Jesus, who's a human being, who's also fully divine. If he's fully divine, how can he have both attributes of human, like he could suffer, or he could change, or he could die, and at the same time be God, who can't die, can't suffer, and can't change, and you have them smashed together in one person, nailed to the cross, what do you do with that, right? And this is kind of the big problem. And over history, different groups of people have done different things with that. Some religions who know about the cross, even make claims about what happened on the cross that are contrary to what Christians make about the cross, because they can't do it. I mean, you just can't have God die. So you have some sects of Christianity who claim like either that Jesus was in some way not really bodily, he was just a spirit up there, and so when he was nailed, could have pulled himself down in time because he wasn't really corporeally there, it was just some kind of spiritual being up on the cross. Or in some traditions, some major religions claim Jesus wasn't crucified at all. At the last minute, somebody else was swapped in his place. And somebody else was crucified on the cross because we can't have the Messiah, Jesus, the Son of God, dying on the cross. That just can't happen. So there has to be some other thing that happened in place of what Christianity claims happens. So you basically have these two kinds of like directions or solutions. One direction or solution that tips things too far one way is just to emphasize really, really strongly Jesus' divinity. So I'm talking about, these are like the major heresies of the early church and the heresies we also deal with today. You either kind of tip towards, he was so divine, he was so God, that he couldn't, and then list up all the things that a God wouldn't do or couldn't do, right? Like, doesn't suffer, can't die. And so those solutions to this issue tip things in the direction of Jesus' being Son of God. People came up with all kinds of solutions about this, like some of the ones that I mentioned. But also, sometimes what they would do is they would split Jesus. So I asked them, who's Jesus on the cross, right? So a lot of the solutions to this are to split it into two persons. One of the great controversies of the early church was diophthalmatism versus monophthalmatism, which I know you all argue about on Sunday afternoons after church, but basically it's like internal to Jesus Christ was there one or two wills. And which will was involved in sticking to it and staying up on the cross? So like maybe according to Christ's human will, he desired to not be on the cross, and the future of God not to be. That's the tears and the praise in the Garden of Gethsemane the night before the execution. But according to his divine will, he was committed and steadfast and stayed out there and didn't have to deal with all the stuff that the human will did. So he split his will, so he's having an internal debate with himself while he's up there on the cross. And the divine will is, I'm sticking to this, and the human will is, get me the hell off this thing, right? It's like this divided person. That's actually the solution Christianity came up with, which I struggle with. We ended up defining diophthalmatism as one of the doctrines of the church, and we struggled to figure out what that means ever since. On the other side, if you really want to emphasize Jesus' humanity, and you don't want to get into this kind of weird cosmological issue, how could a human being be fully God? Because then you introduce all kinds of other questions, like if Jesus is fully God, then where's the rest of God? How can God both be creator of everything and of everything and everywhere, and also be Jesus Christ standing there in front of you? How could that? There's all these logical issues that come up with it, right? So another solution to the issue is to simply say, well, Jesus was just a really amazingly spiritual person who had such a divine intuition of God that God brought Jesus up into the life of God in a unique way, different from all other human beings. This is sometimes called adoptionism. You know, it's like, okay, because he was who he was and what he was like, God adopts Jesus into the divinity of God. You could even say, and some people have said something like this, like God changes in a sense, because by adopting Jesus into the life of God, God in God itself becomes something different than it was by having brought Jesus into God's life. Or you just go with the more normal, that there's always been this potential for a logos of God in the world, and it's finally ultimately manifest when God sees in Jesus everything that the logos could or should be. And so then Jesus is adopted into the life of God, brought into that mix. So you have all these kinds of things that are going on, and they all circle around who is that on the cross. Even the big thing, like what is the Trinity, and how do we talk about the Trinity, and how can it be God in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, is not out there as some kind of mathematical game so that we can all mess with monotheistic traditions who are like, what are you talking about, Christians, when you talk about the Trinity? It's not some kind of a mathematical game. All Trinitarian theology that's been done since Jesus' life, death, and resurrection is all done to try to figure out who was that on the cross. How could his spirit stay with us? How and in what way was God present there in him? All that kind of stuff is all wrapped up into this fundamental question. And I backed up on that because although it's not directly related to the question that you see played out between Peter and Jesus, it indirectly funds all of our imagination about how we hear the story. So in the Peter and Jesus story, what you have right before this event is the same dialogue. Jesus says to Peter and the disciples, who do people say that I am? Who do people say that I am? Top theories are he's Elijah. Elijah didn't die, he went up in a chariot in heaven, so he could come back again, so that's a good possibility. I don't know why anybody didn't propose Enoch, because Enoch did the same thing, but poor Enoch just gets ignored, and Elijah gets all the real interesting credibility as one who went and said it didn't happen. Anyway, if you don't know Enoch, just go read about Enoch in the Bible, he never dies. Elijah, John, maybe John the Baptist to come again. People placed so much hope in John the Baptist, and then he got executed. So their hope is like right thing. Peter knows the right answer. You're the Messiah, Son of the living God. And when he gives that answer, Jesus is like, don't tell anybody about that, right? So it kind of gives this like assent to the notion that he's the Messiah, but then wants to keep it secret. And then when he finally teaches publicly about it, he flips back. This is some fascinating stuff that's going on in this literary text. Like it's very, it's styled this way, in this literary way, on purpose to make us puzzle, right? And the puzzle is, why is it that Jesus wants to keep secret that he's the Messiah and Son of God? But he does, he seeks this. He asks more than once, keep it secret, don't let people know who I am. But then he teaches regularly about who the Son of Man is, or who the Messiah is. And the first thing he teaches about who the Son of Man is, the very first thing is, he's going to die and be crucified, and on the third day rise from the dead. And Peter has just said, you're the Messiah, you're the Son of God. Jesus publicly doesn't say, I'm the Son of God, and I'm going to be crucified and die, and third day rise again. But Peter knows, this is what he's teaching about himself, right? So now Peter, having heard this teaching about the Messiah, is sitting there in the classroom, and he's thinking to himself, Jesus, that is not the Messiah. That's not what we think the Messiah is, right? We've been talking about the Messiah. Lots of us have been talking about the Messiah. We've been talking about the Messiah for a long time, and we know who the Messiah is going to be, but we don't know the particular person the Messiah is going to be, but we know what the Messiah is going to be like and what the Messiah is going to do, right? And what the Messiah is like and what the Messiah is going to do is when the Messiah comes, all this oppressive stuff that we have been going through under Roman rule and disorganization in our religious life and all the grief we have from the civil war that split Israel in the first place and all the pain and all the lament and all the loss and all the oppression of the poor and stopping on the poor Palestinian people, all of that is going to come to an end. Because the Messiah is going to come and fix it. We're going to get a good leader. We're going to get a great president who's going to fix all of this stuff, the mess that we're in. And you're saying that that Messiah is going to die on a cross? No way. Because that's a public shame and nakedness in front of everybody, and in any event, Roman imperial forces only enforce that punishment on people who actually deserve it, Jesus. And the people who deserve it are the poor, the people who can't get their stuff together, the weak who haven't figured out how to politically organize. Somebody who's supposed to die on the cross is not some great Messiah. The people who die on the cross are immigrants and refugees, and poor people. People without political power, that's supposed to be the people who die on the cross, Jesus. And you're going to have the Messiah die on the cross. So they have this big debate. And Jesus comes back at Jesus. And Jesus comes back at Peter and says to him the most fierce rebuke you can possibly imagine. It's not like, well, you've got some of your theology slightly wrong. You got it a little off. Right? No, you get behind me, Satan. Why such a strong rebuke? Why such a huge? Because what Jesus preaches and then lives is going to define forever how Christians think about God. And if we get that wrong, if we get the balance of how this one, this human one, it's another good translation of the Son of Man, if we get it wrong, who this human one is,
Everything else will go wrong. We have to get this right. We have to know who that is. On the cross, and why he's there. And every mess that the church or Christianity ever gets in, whenever it gets stuff wrong from here on out, it will get it wrong because it didn't fully understand this central and core teaching of Jesus. Everything that we get wrong, we get it wrong if we misunderstand this one. I'll give you an example. The largest and most dominant form of Christianity in the United States says that you will be saved and go to heaven if you accept Jesus into your heart. That's how it works. And there's like four steps you could take, right, to do that. Now, it's not that that's completely wrong. Like, I think in general, even people who don't believe in evangelicalism, like I don't, are at least going to say, well, it's a good thing to have Jesus in your heart. I would like to have Jesus in your heart. It's a pretty good thing. But if you were to ask me, like, is that the core of Christianity? Like, that's the thing we're all driving for. I want to get people to accept Jesus into their heart so that they might be saved and go to heaven someday. If you ask me, is that the biggest thing? I would say,